In the ancient church, on Resurrection Sunday, the leader would say, "Christ is risen." The people would say, "He is risen indeed. Christ is risen." A more modern version of that would be, "Christ is risen." And you all would go, "Whoa, yeah!" You know, be like, you know, yelling like at a game or something. And it's absolutely a privilege to come here and worship. You may, if you're going to yell like that, please be sure to swallow the food, right? And the people at your table will appreciate that. But man, what a wonderful breakfast. Thanks for everybody. So we say here that that we want to be a church where friends are made, both of God directly and then also with one another. And so taking time right now and then at the conclusion of the service to try to get to know people and interact and try to enjoy each other here together is just an important part of what we do. It's just absolutely awesome. One of the things that we like to do as friends many times is go to movies. My oldest son went to a movie yesterday. A movie, if you go way back many years, that a lot of people still watch is called The Blues Brothers, and then they remade it later on. And automatically some of you start thinking about all your favorite quotes of the Blues Brothers movie. And one of my favorite quotes, pretty obvious, right? The church dude, what am I going to like? I'm going to like this quote. Say it with me. We're on a mission from God. And as an idea, that's not too shabby. Not too shabby. Now, if you remember the movie, they were on a mission to save an orphanage. There again, not a bad idea, right? I mean, they had been raised in this orphanage, and then the orphanage wasn't able to pay their bills. And so so they get the band back together to go off and perform and try to raise money to be able to save this orphanage. And I started thinking about that as I started thinking about the gospel story in the Bible. And today we're going to be talking about the death and resurrection of Jesus, but also the four books of the Bible that talk about that. And the kids are going to help. The kids that have been in Bible Zone have been learning the books of the Bible, and you've got motions to remember them in sequence. And in about 5 minutes, I'm going to let them come up here and kind of show you what they've been learning. But this whole story, oddly enough, relates not just to the Blues Brothers, but to a whole host of other movies where you've got something or somebody that needs to be saved. And so you've got something or somebody that goes off to save them. Let me just put up a few pictures of a few movies. Maybe you've heard of some of these, like Star Wars or Jaws, or if you go way back, The Bells of St. Mary's was a really popular movie. Harry Potter, in all those settings. And you could probably name, I mean, we could be here all day just naming off different movies where somebody or something is over here in trouble, and somebody or something over here is going to help save. Maybe it's a person that's in need. Maybe it's an orphanage. Maybe it's an organization that's in need, and somehow people are going to help save it. Maybe it's the whole universe. You know, we've got to save the whole universe from he who shall not be named, or from an evil, you know, kind of use of the force. So my question then to myself and to you guys is, why is it that every single culture all around the world loves that kind of narrative, a rescue mission? And we do, right? It doesn't matter what country you're from. These types of movies sell big, and people go and watch them. They engage with that. Every culture loves this whole idea that we're going to go off and save a particular situation. And if you were raised in the church, you know where I'm going with this. Because it's interesting to me that I think that part of the reason we're all in love with those types of movies and those types of books and stories is because we're in the midst of a rescue mission ourselves. Every single one of us, all around the world, every culture, it doesn't matter who you are, you're already in the midst of it. And you're like, wait, I didn't go to casting. I didn't sign up, you know, to be an actor in this play. But you already are in the middle of it. You're already in the middle of it. It's going on right now. Now, the Bible then. The Bible is a storybook, but it's got a lot of other stories within it. But the Bible itself is the number one bestseller, and nothing even comes close. I mean, when you see bestseller lists and they talk about, like, the Twilight Saga or The Alchemist, or, you know, Harry Potter, and they talk about how it's breaking all of these records and everything, usually they'll leave the Bible out of the equation because it's just like this given. If you're in the book industry, you know, okay, the Bible is like so far, you know, surpassing everything else in terms of how many copies it sells that we're just going to like remove it because it throws everything off. But if you do the research, and feel free, Google, you know, see if I'm making this up, and you could probably even find this chart. I mean, we're talking 10 times, 100 times more books sold than these other books. It's like crazy. Why? Why is that? Why? And it's not like just like an American thing or something like that. No. This is originating in Israel. And then, you know, the message, though, is worldwide. God coming to rescue humans. God creates us, but creates us with the freedom to obey him or to disobey him. There's this tempter that's allowed by God to give us those options. And then our ancestors chose to go against God. We choose many times to go against God. And so then we put ourselves in the situation of needing rescued. God comes and rescues us. So the Bible is one book, but how many books are there within the Bible itself? That's a kind of a trick question, right? Because different churches count a little differently. But 66, that's the number of books that are being taught, you know, kind of behind the scenes with the Bible Zone folks. And I'm going to turn this over to them and let them try to explain those. All right? So, Bible Zone kids, would you guys come on up here. And any of you adults that are going to be helping, you can come on up too. You can use this as like a step if you want over here, or you can just jump up, whatever. You come over here, come up here. Nice. All right. Now when you guys do the motions, do you do them standing up or sitting down? Either one? Oh, nice, I like it. All right, so you guys can sit down here like that. All right, good deal. Ooh. Well, you guys look sharp. What do you think? All right. Yeah, I like that. All right. So, who's the best leader of this? What do you think? I love it. You guys want to? You go? Okay. All right. You guys come down here. Yep. Come on down. All right. Come down here. Okay. And then turn and face them, you know, so you can help prompt them and stuff. Is that cool? All right. Now, I don't know them, so I'm going to come over here. I'm going to let you help me, all right? Don't look back. You want to stand up? All right, let's stand up. You only know what? Only the Old Testament. And I'm going to help you with the New Testament books. All right, Becca and Ella, lead us. Genesis, okay, it's like the world, okay. Exodus, like parting the Red Sea, I like it. Leviticus, yep. Numbers. Deuteronomy, Joshua. Wait, what is that one? Judges, like a judge. I like it, okay. What is that one? Ruth, okay, like picking up. First and Second Samuel, okay, got it. First Second Kings, Chronicles, okay. Ezra, Nehemiah. Esther, okay, I like it. Ooh, Job. Wait. What was this one? Job, because he like had skin issues and stuff and got sick and stuff. Okay, gotcha. All right, Psalms, okay. Proverbs, tell you what to do. Ecclesiastes, I don't know. I like that one. Song of Solomon, was this one? Oh, the ring, because he was a king. I like it, yeah. Oh, marriage. I like it. Isaiah, go. I like that one. J for Jeremiah. Okay. These are the tough ones. I get confused, too. This is called, you just flip. Oh, no problem. So we went up through Jeremiah. I love it. And you weren't here, that's cool. See, I wasn't either, that's why I was up here. That's exactly right. Watch this. Let's look out here to the adults. How many of you, without looking up there, could have named off all of those books all the way through, you know? So a few. Oh, you know them up here, but not the motions yet. I love it. All right, so let's give them a hand. Thanks a lot. Give me five. Ooh, good job. Nice. Oh, thanks, man. Thank you. Nice. Absolutely awesome. That's pretty cool. I had no idea that my my kid's favorite book of the Bible was Ecclesiastes. I like it. Who did it? Ecclesiastes, I like it. No, that's really, really cool. So check it out. So today, Miss Laura gave me the curriculum that would have been taught this very day in Bible Zone behind the scenes. So if you're new here, the kids in this service, you can check in through those doors, and then down the hallway there's a kids area. You get to check in there, and then they get to learn about Jesus in their own kind of time, in their own kind of way. And the lesson today had two particular scripture passages that were kind of like the memorization passages. Some of you that were raised in the church, these will be very familiar, but for some it'll be brand new. 2 Timothy 3:16. This is not the translation I personally memorized it in back with the dinosaurs, but with this translation, I really like it. This makes it a little more clear. God has breathed life into all scripture. It is useful for teaching us what is true. It is useful for correcting our mistakes. It is useful for making our lives whole again. And it is useful for training us to do what is right. I like that. I like that a lot. How about that? And so that is a letter written to a young pastor by the mentoring pastor saying, look, here's how important it is to understand the Bible. And it's complicated, but if you dig in and you keep working at it and trying to learn it, it's useful for even helping our lives to be whole again. I love it. Because God's inspiring writing to be passed down to us so that we can participate in being rescued by God. It's like an instruction manual. It's like a love letter. It's like all those different types of things. And in that book of the Bible, we have the book of John, Jesus's kind of best friend. I mean, this is a really important guy in the Bible. And he writes in chapter 3, verses 16 and 17 of his book, this is the other memorization passage, for God so loved the what? The whole world? Not just Ohio? But he loves Ohio, right? God so loved the whole world that he gave his what? One and only son. And the old way of saying that is only begotten son. This is the only son that is both God and human, 100% both. Now, you can be a son or a daughter of God by having the Holy Spirit of God come within you, but you are a separate created being. Jesus is the only begotten son that is both God and human entirely. He gave his only son that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have what? Eternal life. Now, that sounds pretty cool, right? And so saves us from eternal death, saves us from all the horrible things that hurts us, gives us eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world. Have you ever known any Christians that kind of ignored that verse? That's wrong. You're wrong. You're a sinner. Now, all of that is theologically true, but Jesus isn't the one that reminds you of that. Satan does. Because he wants you to give up. He wants you to be depressed. He wants you to be separate from God. He wants you to think that you're absolutely worthless. And sometimes he's very persuasive. You may say, sometimes I've felt entirely worthless. Well, that's exactly what he wants. And he wants you isolated from people. Friendships are not easy, are they? No, that's one of the reasons why that's an essential part of what we try to do here as a church. Because we realize it's going to be a lot easier for people to get offended and to kind of break off from each other and that kind of thing. God wants us both in relationship with him and with each other in this way that we're one. And so he sends Jesus on that rescue mission to save the world through him. Save us. Save us from ourselves. I need to be saved from myself sometimes. I do stupid stuff sometimes. Amen. You don't know me that well. Otherwise, it would have been like, amen, right? Yeah, that's exactly right. So we got to be safe from ourselves, safe from other people, safe from all this horrible stuff that wants to drag us down, wants us depressed, isolated, alone, and then feel like we're worthless. So through this, then, we're given the Bible. Now, all right, so kids, here's some new motions, and the adults can do these with me. All right, are you ready? Let's make a giant M because we're going to start with the book of Matthew. We've got Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Matthew's got the big M because it's bigger than Mark. Mark's got a little M. See there? Make the little M. Matthew, Mark. It's an upside down W. Oh my goodness! You know, it's like, wow, now I see. So Matthew, big. Mark, little. And we'll talk more about them here in a second. Luke's my favorite. Let me see. How would you make an L? You'd be like, it's got to go that way. So there's Luke, you're my father, or I'm your father, right? Yeah. Okay, we know. Now, it's easier to remember, right? So you got Luke. So you got Matthew, Mark, Luke. Now, John, there's also, later in the Bible, there's 1 John, 2 John, 3 John. So if all we did were J's, plus Jeremiah already got the J, because he came before John, you know. So what they came up with for John is a W, which I love, because we're on the west side. I love it. So why W? Because in John, in the very first part of John, it's in the beginning was the Word. And everybody from the 80s is like, yes, word up, yeah. And a lot of the younger kids are like, I have no idea what you're talking about, but that's kind of fun to say. Word, exactly. Wait till you see the picture of John I've got for you here in just a minute. I can't wait. All right, so let's go back through these kind of one at a time, all right? So Matthew is longer than what book? That's exactly right. Now, these are biographies. They are stories of Jesus. They tell about Jesus, but from four different perspectives. In your bulletin, if you're a real academic type of person, in your bulletin, we have a little insert that my buddy Fritz helped put together from some resources that talk about why we think these are authentic, why you can trust them. Even though they're a couple thousand years old, we have copies upon copies that are trustworthy. We have total knowledge that it's close to when these events actually happened, which is very different from most ancient writing. You know, most ancient writing, it was like hundreds of years later, and then somebody decided, oh, we're going to write this down. These are like within 30 years of Jesus. That's crazy. So there are people still alive that could say, Matthew, right on. That's exactly right. And then they would look at this other writing and be like, dude, you made up a lot of that. You made it up. This is crazy. And so churches would start to not use the made up ones, and they would say, ooh, this is accurate. Ask Gertrude over there. She was alive when Jesus was walking and talking. Is this right? And she'd be like, yeah, that's right. Let's use that. So Matthew wrote to Hebrew folks that knew Hebrew. Guess what language that is up there? That's Hebrew. That's a Hebrew version of the book of Mark. It's really cool. And when you read Hebrew, some rabbis will use like a pointer because they don't want to miss anything. They want to make sure they get every little word right. And so Matthew quotes the Old Testament to help Hebrew people, Jewish people that know that Old Testament, he quotes it a lot so that they'll know it. Mark, show me the motion for Mark. Mark, kids, little m, because Mark's short. It's a shorter book. If you're going to memorize a book of the Bible, go to Mark, not Matthew. It's going to make it easier on you, right? Why would it maybe be a shorter book? Well, sometimes when you're writing to somebody, let's say that you're writing to a businessman that's really, really, really busy. And I've heard of business professionals, I just read recently, where this kind of like a personal trainer was told by multiple different business professionals, give me a 3x5 card on how to lose weight and I'll do it. I don't want your program, I don't want to listen. I want the facts right now. Maybe you know a lady in business like that, and when you go into her office, she just wants you, you know, just give me the facts. So Mark's writing to somebody of that kind of personality type, and so he just jumps right in with the story of Jesus as an adult. Doesn't get into here's how he was born and the great Christmas story and stuff. You've just got him, just kind of giving it to him short and sweet. Luke. Am I making the L the right direction, or is it this way? This way? Okay. Luke. Now, Luke does. He gives a lot of details about the birth of Jesus. At Christmas time, we typically read the Luke story of when Jesus was born. And it so happened in those days that all the world should be registered or taxed. And so Mary and Joseph went to Bethlehem. That's Luke, man. That's him. Now, why is all these little pictures? Because Luke's like a scholar. He's more like a historian of today, where you would get all these eyewitness testimonies and you would figure them out and you would try to put them in some kind of order that made sense. He's very methodical like that. And so if you're kind of a brainiac, kind of a nerd person, you know, like me, then you're going to love Luke. And I love Luke, you know. He also wrote Acts, which is what I'm preaching through and continuing on next week. Now, John. Yes, I know that looks like Jerry Garcia. I'm sorry. But I love that because John's kind of artsy. John uses more poetic language. John, I mean, if you love music and you love art and those types of things, you're probably going to love John more than Luke, you know, because John is like, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. I mean, that's like a freestyle poet, right? I mean, it truly is like really, really, really cool like that. And so when John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. I mean, that's why that's so memorable, right? John is like the one that's going to get at your heartstrings. He's going to connect, you know? And he's the one that got to die a natural death, although he was in exile on an island. So all the Christians eventually, the Roman Empire, for a period of time, didn't like, you know, kind of, you know, because they were like, ooh, Jesus is the king, more important than Caesar. But you get this idea. John was trying to communicate God's revelation to us. He uses it poetic language, and it's really, really, really powerful. So, all right, so you've got Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. You've got the motions, right? You know the story. So John 3:16 and 17, this is like the little version of the big story. God so loved the world that he sent his son to save us. And when Jesus came to save us, he came to save us, not make us feel worse, because a lot of us were already feeling bad, you know? So the last thing you needed was somebody to come in and make you feel worse. And as you notice, when Jesus is really confrontational about people's sin in the Bible, it's to the church people. It's to the religious people that are looking down on other people. That's what got Jesus really mad. And he like goes into the temple and starts throwing tables around and, you know, using a whip. And that's when he started calling people vipers. And he gets in people's face when they start looking down on other people. That's why we're trying here to create a culture where, no, I don't care what you wore to come to Easter service. Like, I truly don't care. I'm thrilled that you have clothes on. If you didn't, that I might have been upset about. Other than that, like, I truly don't care, right? I truly don't. And most of the folks around here, right, they are excited you're here. Amen? Like, that's just awesome. That's exactly right. So Jesus, when he hung out with sinners, they wanted him there. What does that mean? That means like they knew that he loved them, and it was fun. Like joyful. Joy is one of the fruits of the Spirit. And sometimes religious people, folks that say they like Jesus and know Jesus, but they really don't, they get really mad at people that feel joy, and they start kind of tearing them down. It's crazy that that's the case, but it happens, you know? If you're thankful that Jesus has freed you of stuff, you're going to still have some rough edges, and we're going to help each other on that. But we're not going to be like, okay, I don't want to be around you because you still haven't overcome that yet. No, we're all working on that. You can look around at everybody at your table and say to them, you're a mess. No, don't do that right now. Don't do that. Because they would say that to you too. And there is something about you in your life that's probably a mess that God is still in the process of saving you from. He's saying, I'm going to give you eternal life, but let's keep working on some of these rough edges. And he was joyful and he was patient. So he came to save the world. So if you were to say, okay, what's the main point of the Bible? I'm going to give you a few of the points. The first one is get saved. Now, the old style of that, I want to just kind of think that through in a second. Of more like getting saved from drowning. Like you're flopping around in the water. Maybe you're disoriented. Maybe you fell from a great height. Somehow, maybe you used to be able to swim, but because of the fall, you can't swim anymore. And the whole idea that God's going to do for you and for me what we can't do for ourselves. That's grace. He's going to do for us what we can't do for ourselves. He's going to somehow save us. And then he's going to help us to save others. Because the whole idea of, once I'm saved, if I look around, and you get this, if a ship goes down and you find a piece of wood to hold on to and you think that it could hold another person up above the water and you see a drowning person, are you going to be like paddling away from them? No. You're going to be like, hey, come on, I've found this wood that can hold both of us above water, and you're going to try to save some other folks. You're going to try to save them. So the first two images. Here's the first one. Jesus on the left or the right? It's exactly right. He's the one on the left. And this is when Jesus was walking on the water. Peter starts off good. You know, he's like, I'm a good person. I'm walking on water. I see God pretty clearly. And then he starts to sink because he gets freaked out because of the waves. And for you or for me, maybe it was a friend that just kind of made us kind of make some bad decisions. Or maybe it was, you know, we started thinking sorry for ourselves, and we're just kind of start sinking, and we realize, wait a second, now I'm doing some bad stuff, or I'm looking at some bad stuff, or I'm treating my kids with more anger than I should, or I'm not being loving to these people around me, man. I gotta get saved. Somebody's gotta save me from this stuff. And there are pop culture songs that you'll hear on the radio about somebody save me, you know? And it's like, even if you don't know Jesus, you know that feeling, you know, I need somebody to save me. So God sends Jesus with the right way to live and teaching, but also to die for us, raised from the dead, so that we're not even afraid of death at that point. You say, if Jesus can give me eternal life, then I'm with him, I'm totally in. And like, can he? Well, the four biographers that are all different say that he rose from the dead. Now, they differ in their way of getting at it. And if you're a cop, you're like, okay, that makes sense. You know, if they were all exactly alike, you'd think that they just all cheated off of each other entirely or all made it up and all got together and said, this is what we're going to say. But because they're different and yet the same, you look at them and you say, why? Wait, Jesus can really do this. Some of you know that, and we hear your testimonies about that. Now, the next picture is kind of related to that, you know? It's this whole idea that once you're saved and you get a little bit stronger and you're able to swim a little bit better, you're able to handle the waves, you're partnering with other people. The Coast Guard folks don't go out one by one, do they? No, that'd be stupid. You know, we all go out kind of together in community to be able to help each other. So that if we're trying to help somebody and we can't quite help them on our own, somebody else, some other diver's going to jump in and be like, look, I'll partner with you in that. I'll help you, you know? And so now we're going to look around and we're going to say, hey, who else needs to know that God loves them? Who else needs to know that Jesus has died for them? That as they punish themselves, and some people are punishing themselves like literally, right? They're cutting. They're causing pain to deal with a deeper pain. Why do we do that? Well, we do that because we know we need something else, but we can't get out of that pain. Jesus is trying to reach in and say, I absorb the pain. I've become sin. I've done that to kill it and to be destroyed on the cross, dying, and then I'm going to raise from the dead. So let's go to the next slide, guys. Then, once you're saved, now this is interesting, because sometimes we then forget to live, or that it's okay to live. You know, it's okay for you to be joyful, even though there are starving people in the world. Let me say that again. Because some of us struggle with this, including this guy. It's okay for you to be joyful, even though there are starving people in the world. It's not okay for us to ignore the fact that there are starving people in the world. But if we go and we help starving people, and we're depressed and mad and complaining all the time, the starving people may be like, I'm good. Like, your God is not that impressive, right? I mean, if you convincing me to believe your way is going to lead me to be just as jerky and just as sad and just as upset and just as down about myself and the world as you are right now, no thanks. When Jesus fed people, they had come to him because he's joyful and because he has a solution. And he could do miracles. We, the church, we can be joyful, not because we're all that, but because we have the solution that's Jesus, who brings joy, and when we're living right, helps us all to share and to be blessed to the point that nobody has that level of need where they're going to starve to death. The reason people starve to death in this world is because of selfishness. It's not because there's not enough food. Right, you science people out there? We can feed the world. We've got it figured out. We just don't do it. Except in certain circumstances, we do. And typically when you find people that are really trying to help other people and they're excited to go and help them, there's some level of joy in their heart because they realize, wait, I'm forgiven, I'm being provided for, I'm reaching out to them, and there are all kinds of things that are going to try to drag me down, but I'm not going to let them. I'm not going to let them because Jesus has overcome. Jesus has overcome those horrible things. Jesus loves me, loves them, and he's going to help me to live. So this picture in this particular movie, you know, the lady on the right had a really difficult marriage and situation, and then through prayer and through some reconciliation, got some level of peace before her marriage got better. I like that part of the movie because that's kind of true to life. Before things really started getting better all around her, she felt some strength and she started telling Satan off, you know, get out of my house. You're not going to steal my joy. You're not going to steal my joy. I like that because Satan wants to steal your joy. And the minute you get happy that you can provide something for your kids, and then once you make you feel guilty about that, and you think, well, no, wait a second. I'm going to provide for my kids, and then I'm going to teach my kids. We're going to try to provide for other people too. Like, we're going to try to do that, you know, and we're going to be joyful about that, and we're going to truly live a saved life. What's eternity going to look like in heaven? Is it going to be? No, it's not. Like, you're encountering the one about whom the Bible says is love. God is, guess which of the disciples, which one of the authors of the Gospels wrote that? John, not in his Gospel, in one of his letters. Well, say it with me, God is love. God is love. God is love. And love brings joy. So we get right with God. Which you can start doing right now. God, I want to get right with you. I want to be forgiven by you. I want you to change me from the inside out. I'm an impatient person, Lord. I want all of my rough edges to be smoothed out at once. But if you take, you know, 30 or 40 years, okay, it's going to be all right. I'm going to keep going. And then I'm going to look around and find out who doesn't have joy, who doesn't have peace. And I'm going to try to help them to pray and live with that kind of belief and that kind of trust in the Lord. And we're going to start saving other people and just encouraging other people. And as we do that, we're going to live lives of joy because we're experiencing God's love. So God, as you continue to love us, we're going to love you back. We're going to care about and love the people around us. And we're going to tell Satan, leave us alone. And we're going to tell the depression to leave us alone. And we're going to tell the things that are trying to drag us down, leave us. And we're going to claim that power of the resurrected Jesus is within us. You see how that works, right? And so then as you're walking into work, and it may be kind of tough, and you say, wait a second, I'm going to live eternal life right now. I'm not going to wait till I'm dead. So I'm going to walk into that workplace and say, I don't care what you're giving me to do. I'm just going to have joy anyway. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to say, I'm living an eternal life right now. And at school, if some bullies start picking on me, I'm going to start praying for them because obviously they've got a problem. And that problem isn't me. The problem is them. They need something. And so I'm going to pray for them to be saved. I'm just going to pray for those bullies, right? And as they pick on me, I'm just going to keep praying for them. Lord, help them to know you. Help them to get away from Satan. Help them to overcome temptation. And for those neighbors that you have and those other friends, you're just going to keep praying for them as well. You see how that works? Isn't that cool? All right, so we're going to end a little bit early today, and then we're going to allow you to have some times of joy around your tables and just encouraging people, saying, hey, bless you, I'm glad that you're here. There are things in the bulletin going on that just blew my mind. I mean, we're going to go throw a Star Wars party off-site and help people to know that God loves them in the midst of a Star Wars party. That's kind of cool. That's kind of cool, isn't it? We're going to invite ladies to the church that we're just going to pamper them, you know? And one of the ladies in the church, Bernie, is helping us put that together. Okay, how are we going to just kind of serve them, you know, and help them, and just all those, you've heard about this. We've got life groups that are going on. Why do you try to get in a life group? So that you can help other people, help each other, keep connecting with the Lord. So I'm going to pray one more time, and the band's going to come up here and sing. And the next time I'm going to come up here is just going to be to invite you to encourage each other, okay? And I have a very specific way to do that. So let's pray. Lord, as the band comes to lead us in worship, on this Easter, we pray a blessing on every one of these kids that was up here. Bless them. Help them to do well in school. Help them to learn to love you and to pray. We pray for the parents and the grandparents and all the guardians that are helping to care for them. We pray that you would lift them up and encourage them today. Help them to feel loved and encouraged. Lord, thank you so much for what you're doing. We pray for the folks here that have more years behind them than ahead of them, and yet they're making the most of this day. They're saying, you know what? I'm going to live for you right now, Lord. I'm going to live in eternity. I'm going to live with that joy and that happiness. And so, Lord, would you fill all of us with your love and with your peace and your grace, and help us to be friends of you and friends of each other. In Jesus' name, we pray and we declare, saying, amen. 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 Amen.